The following Car Geek Hour is a paid advertisement program provided by Cassill Motors, and airing of the program is not to be considered endorsement or recommendation. The opinions expressed are those of the host, guests, and callers, and not necessarily those of WMT or Clear Channel Media and Entertainment.
All right. Good morning. 600 WMT, 52 degrees here at Broadcast Park. Michael Yersby this morning. And as we do every week that we can, we've got Jay Cassill. And Jay, how are you doing this morning?
I am absolutely awesome.
That's right.
You know, this week has been a magnificent week.
Yeah, we've been, you know, we were talking before we got on here, and we got a lot to touch on.
Oh, my goodness.
You know, here.
We got so much stuff to talk about, you know. As always, I love fixing cars, so don't wait till the end to call.
That's right.
Let's get our calls coming in right away. You know, whether you got a question on your car, truck, van, motorcycle, SUV, we had some tractor calls there not too long ago.
Mm-hmm.
We can figure it out. I love to do it. I love to go for test drives with people. If you're looking at buying a car or maybe you're wanting to, go trade your car in. Give me a call. I'll give you some tips on how to get the most out of your trade-in too. You know, so we do all kinds of fun stuff. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, it's just been a blast.
Yep. I want to give those numbers here really quick.
Yes.
365-0600, 1-800-332-5401, or *600 on your U.S. cellular phone. Phone lines are open right now, so give us a call. Like Jay said, don't wait until the last minute. We always seem to have that. People just, you know, they like to crowd up the last end of the hour, but we're here for a full hour today.
Yeah.
So we've got this whole hour that, you know, we can help people.
There you go.
So we want to make sure that they know that.
Talking about helping people,
mm-hmm.
You know, last Saturday we teamed up or helped out General Mills. They do their big fundraiser for United Way. We had a magnificent show. It was unbelievable. Debbie Smith puts on that deal for General Mills, and she was like on top of it. You know, her daughter Charisma does a car show. And they had almost 140 cars, I think, was the count on cars. And you talk about some magnificent cars. It was, oh, my gosh. I had a blast. It was like Car Geek Central. My head was spinning around, about popped off. It was like, wow, this is cool. And then I turn around. It's like, oh, my God, this is cool, too. It was fun.
Were you able to get some photos of the cars and stuff?
They got a bunch of photos. I was not able to. I was parking cars.
Mm-hmm.
And just like I said, my head was spinning because it was just like, oh, my God, this thing's cool. Oh, my God, there's a big block Mustang. Oh, no, there's a Ford retractable. There's 69 Camaro. It's like, wow. I mean, it's just, oh, it was awesome. They had a great turnout. The poker run, they had almost 50 bikes on the poker run.
Wow.
Awesome crowd. it was unbelievable. It was for United Way and Boys and Girls Club of Cedar Rapids. So it was a cool deal. Mm-hmm. So a lot of fun. So good job, guys, on that.
Yep. And also, I know you guys had the bike show for Chrome Horse, and I want to make sure we touch on that too. But
yep.
Right now we got a phone call here, so we're going to get to that. We do. So we're going to go ahead and talk to Paul. Good morning, Paul.
Oh,
good morning.
Listen, Jay, I do not call you every week. It's been about a month now.
Okay.
But I've got a good one for you.
Okay.
A neighbor came over there the day. He's got a 99 Cavalier with a four-cylinder 2.4 engine.
Yep.
He came over and he said, I thought my transmission acted a little funny, and I went to check the fluid, and I can't find a dipstick.
You can't find
the
dipstick?
I said, oh, for heaven's sake, I'll find it for you.
Yeah?
So I went over and looked. There's no dipstick on that car to check the transmission. What's the deal on that?
Well, there is a dipstick. Well, there's two different ways, but yes, that does have – it should still have a dipstick, but it's not what you're thinking. Okay?
Okay.
When you're looking down at the engine
– yeah.
When you're looking in the engine compartment to the right side, but you're going to go into the front, there's like a round knob that's on top of the transmission. You got to kind of reach back around underneath the air tube and everything, and that's where the dipstick is.
It's down on top of the transmission.
It's down on top.
Is that right?
Yep. It's not like the old car where we got a long dipstick tube and dipstick. This is a deal. It screws right into the top of the transmission.
Well, I got to unscrew it, and then it'll have a stick on the other end of the cap.
It's got a little stub on the end of it. So.
All right, now this would be on. Am I standing on the driver's side when I'm doing this, or on the passenger side?
You're standing right directly in front of it.
Right in front of the car.
Right in front of it, and then it's going to be to the right side of you.
Now behind the motor on top of the transmission.
Yep, behind the motor on top of the transmission.
Can I screw it out with my fingers, or it takes a wrench?
You should be able to screw it out with your fingers.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right.
Okay.
I'll take a look at that.
Not
thanks
a problem.
Thanks a lot for the help on that, because it certainly had me puzzled.
Not a problem.
All right. Thanks a lot, Jay.
Thank you.
Bye.
All right. Thanks for the call this morning, Paul.
We love callers from Ottumwa.
Mm-hmm. We love all callers.
We love all callers. You're right.
365-0600, 1-800-332-5401, *600 on your U.S. cellular phone. You know, I wasn't able to ask last week, but I actually have a car question that maybe you can help me out with.
I don't work on Stratuses.
Oh. Okay, so
we gotta get you a better
so
car.
My okay. friend has a car.
Okay.
That's not a Stratus.
Okay.
No, we recently, I know I've told you about the issues that we had with the wheel bearing hub assembly on it.
Yep.
We changed that, fixed that problem. It was great. Come to find out that now when I'm slowing down, I'm getting like a shaking thing, and my brother, when he had the wheel off, he was looking at the brake pad. The brake pad wasn't, or not the pad, the rotor was not wearing evenly, and it was causing it to, you know, vibrate. Why is it that happens on some of those rotors?
Now, it wasn't, you got to fill in this a little better on wearing evenly. Both sides of the rotor were showing wear, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But one side, only part of the rotor?
Like part of it was, you know, nice and smooth, but then there was a section of it that looked like it was just a little bit rougher, like it wasn't smoothed out like the rest of the rotor was.
What happens is, does your car sit every once in a while for a longer period of time?
No more than a few hours, because I use it every day.
Okay. What happens, these new rotors, we get the material is real, for lack of better words, they're junk.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens is the moisture makes them rust overnight, and we'll get some pitting that happens, and then it won't clean up. So
okay.
that's probably what you're seeing on that there. A little bit of that, or maybe you got the brakes real hot one time and stopped and parked it, and it'll embed into the rotor a little bit there too. Mm-hmm. You're doing some racing or something.
Yes, and my Stratus.
I've seen you come around the corner before. You try to get that thing on two wheels.
I mean, I know when I changed them, they were newer ones, but they were like a cheaper rotor. And because my brother told me, he's like, I need to go and grind down your pads. And then he goes, I'm going to put some Mopar, you know, rotors on some, you know, some nice ones.
Yep. You always want to make sure the other thing that causes some problems there too is that the wheels are torqued properly. You know, so many times people use these torque sticks, or they zip them on with an impact, and then they take a torque wrench and they put it on there. Yep, okay, it's torqued. The proper way when you're putting a wheel on, that lug nut should turn at least a half a turn to a full turn before it gets to its proper torque spec, before the torque wrench clicks.
Mm-hmm.
So, because if you just put a torque wrench on and touch it and it clicks, is it really at 95 foot-pounds, or is it at 130?
Mm.
You don't know. But if you get that lug nut to turn a full turn, then you know that it's torqued properly.
Mm.
So that's a big thing on these new rotors, too.
All right. Well, let's get to some phone calls here.
Yeah,
let's go ahead and go to Randy in Iowa City. Good morning, Randy.
Hello.
Good morning.
Yeah, I've got a 2007 Volkswagen Eos.
Okay.
A hard top.
Okay.
With a 2.0 turbo in it.
Yeah.
And how do you get to the air cleaner?
How do you get to the air cleaner?
Yeah. It's covered up with plastic.
Yeah. You got to pull off that plastic.
And I've tried to get that off. Looked under. Have you ever had one off?
To tell you exactly how it comes off, I'd have to look at it to see, but usually the cover on that engine, there's usually a couple bolts, or your oil cap usually will we'll be holding it down. If you take the oil cap off, then there's usually some plastic clips that it pops up to get it, to get that cover off. But look around, there might be a couple bolts on it. GM put some bolts on before, but there's got to be a couple clips holding that on there, and usually the oil cap also holds it on.
Well, I don't think they're all, because I changed it. I finally figured out how to change the oil. You have to take a cover off the bottom of it.
Isn't that great, how they cover everything up? Yeah.
So, all right, I'll look around a little more, but it just feels like there's something in the center of it that's bolted on.
Yeah, there's a clip usually that it's a push-on deal. So kind of pull up on the edge and look underneath it if you can, and you'll see that it's, if there's, is there a Volkswagen emblem in the center of that? Now that I think about
Yes, there is. I already broke that off. I thought maybe something was underneath there holding it on.
Okay. There's probably a push-on clip underneath that. So.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Thanks for the call this morning, Randy. Let's go ahead now and go to Denny in Cedar Rapids. Good morning, Denny.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yes, I have a 2001 Pontiac Grand Prix with a 3.8 in it.
Oh, awesome setup, yes.
And I bought it in 2003. But
okay.
It's always been an issue with, I always get a check engine light, which is a PO446.
Okay.
Which is the evaporated emission control system vent.
Yep.
Control.
Yep.
I don't drive it every day. It's just kind of a, I have a work truck, so I don't drive it every day.
Right.
I'm trying to figure out what's causing this issue, because I can clear the code.
Right.
Because I have a code reader.
Yep.
I guess it don't make sense that every week or, it might go a week, it might go a month or what, and then this silly thing will come on.
Okay.
Any ideas?
Yeah. We need to fix the problem.
I agree.
You can keep clearing that code all you want. It's going to keep coming back. Need to look at it and see, but you either have a small leak in the evap system. The evap system runs from the engine back to the gas tank.
Yep.
So there could be a small leak in one of the plastic lines. Could have your vent solenoid valve that's bad up in the front, or it could be back in the canister, back in the back of the car.
Right.
Need to look at the code for sure and see. But the one way of telling if it's saying it's a small leak, we need to put the smoke machine on it. And what we do is you put smoke machine on it, and where the leak is, we'll have smoke coming out, and we can repair it.
I understand. Okay.
Yeah, and then they can fix that. That's real common on those.
Okay.
Yep.
So what you're telling me, I need to bring it to a shop.
Unless you got a smoke machine, you probably need to bring it to a shop.
All right.
Okay. I hate to say that. So, but
I do remember when I first bought the car that they replaced that canister in the back.
And it's
now does that go bad every now and then or?
Oh yeah, it could be a deal that every couple of years you had to put a new one on it. So.
Well, I'm wondering if.
Don't do what I think you're going to do. Don't just go buy a canister and put on it.
I know.
Yeah.
No,
we don't replace parts. We diagnose and fix.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, a person always wants the easy way out.
I know. Don't guess, because guessing costs you more money. So let's diagnose it. If you wanted to, I would be more than happy to put our smoke machine on it for you. And if you want to fix it yourself, I don't have a problem with that, but we would help you out on that part there. I'd help you diagnose it.
So how do I go about that deal?
We'll call into the shop and set up an appointment, and you tell them you talked to Jay on the radio, and I'll get involved with it, and we'll help you out.
Well, Jay, I sure appreciate it.
No problem. I appreciate your call in, Denny.
Okay, you take care now.
You too. Right. Thanks.
Bye.
Bye.
All right, thanks for the call, Denny. 365-0600, 1-800-332-5401, *600 on your U.S. cellular phone. Looks like we got Jason in Newhall. We're going to get to him right when we come back. His phone call
breaks.
And more. Yep.
Oh, I hate
break
breaks.
Time.
I hate breaks.
First of three.
Okay.
All right, so we'll get to Jason as soon as we come back, as well as your phone calls here on the Castle Motor Car Geek Hour. Jay Cassill right here on 600 WMT.
There was a couple little coupes at the show last weekend.
Was there?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Cool.
As well as all kinds of other stuff out there.
There was all kinds of neat stuff.
All right, Michael, you're here this morning. We're talking with Jay Cassill from Cassill Motors. It's the Cassill Motor Car Geek Hour, as we do every Saturday.
We got lines open.
We do have lines open.
Yes, we do.
365-0600, 1-800-332-5401, *600 on your U.S. cellular phone, which is where we're going to start. We've got Jason in Newhall. He was patient enough to wait through
there
the break, so we appreciate that, Jason. Good morning. How you doing, Jason?
Pretty good. How about yourself?
We are absolutely awesome today.
It's a great day to be a Hawkeye.
That's right. There you go. What can we do for you?
Well, I got a question. I got an 02 Intrepid. It's got the 2.7.
Okay.
And I'm leaking some oil. I'm losing about a little over a quart a month.
Okay.
I'm running conventional 1040 in it, and I'm not seeing any puddles underneath it at all.
Okay.
So I'm just kind of curious if you guys had any insight as to what you think it could potentially be.
So you're losing oil, not leaking oil.
I'm at a quart about every month or a little more. So.
About how many miles are you putting on a month?
Oh, I'm running about 3,000 miles every about 4 months.
Okay.
I'm not putting a lot of miles in the commuter car, so.
Okay. The first thing you want to look at on it, if you're not seeing a lot of oil in the tailpipe area, I want to look at my PCV system on it, your crankcase ventilation system. How many miles does the car have on it?
130.
Okay. Most likely nobody's ever done anything with the PCV system. It's the most overlooked thing on the engine. And what happens is the valve will start going bad, and it starts sucking a little bit of oil in. And you won't see it. You won't see it as far as blue smoke coming out the tailpipe, and, of course, it doesn't leak at that point. But the first place I'd be looking at is my PCV system, making sure the valve is good, and make sure you clean out all the lines when you replace it. So, and that's where I'd start out first.
Okay.
Okay.
Do you guys got time for one more quick question?
Of course we do. Mm-hmm.
Definitely. It's on air conditioning. I know we're kind of past that season, but
yeah.
I had my compressor go out right at the end of the season.
Yep.
And do you guys recommend just replacing the compressor, or do you recommend going further into, like, the condenser and things like that when the compressor goes out?
You don't have to do the condenser, but you definitely need to do the receiver dryer. And
right.
then if there's an orifice tube, the filter there, you want to do that. And then what they'll do is they'll clean the whole system. They can, the evaporator and condenser, they can run a cleaner through and blow that out, clean that all out real good, get any contaminants out of there, which there shouldn't be. With your receiver dryer, should catch that between that and the orifice tube. But have it cleaned out, and I have no problem doing a compressor, receiver dryer, and the filter orifice tube type deal. Okay.
Okay. Very good. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you.
Bye.
All right. Thanks for the call, Jason.
I always like lots of calls.
Yeah, we love lots of calls.
As many questions as you want.
Exactly.
I'm easy.
See?
Yeah. Yeah.
Easy as pie.
Yeah. Just don't tell my wife. Yeah. There you go.
All right. Let's go to Shane and Walford next here. Good morning, Shane.
Hi. How are you guys?
We are absolutely awesome. How about you?
Good. Well, I got a... I'll start here. We got a 99 Chevy Silverado. I got the 5.3 in it.
Okay.
And I got right at about 250,000 miles on it.
Perfect.
So we're talking a lot of miles.
Yeah.
But okay, so this morning, it's sort of coincidental. The first time I've seen it since it got cold, my service light come on.
Uh-huh.
And I really started noticing this last spring and last fall. It seems like it varies with the temperature.
Okay.
So, like, say this morning was cold out, it was on. As soon as the day warmed up, it goes off, and vice versa.
Okay. Well, the thing you're going to run into, if a check engine light, if you have a sensor that's bad on the engine, the check engine light will stay on.
Okay.
It won't go off.
Sure.
The only thing that'll make a check engine light go back off is if it's got an evap leak. Okay. So we have something with the temperature. Evap leak can be as simple as a gas cap. Did you just recently put gas in it?
No.
Okay.
It's low on the empty side.
Okay. You want to look at, the first place I'd start at, especially with 250,000 miles, I'd pull off my gas cap, and there's a rubber seal around the gas cap. Look at that seal. If it's dry rotted, which I'm expecting it's going to be, put a new gas cap on it.
Yeah, I'm sure it's original.
Yep.
I've had this truck since 01. So.
Okay. Yeah, so look at that there. See what you got. Do you live on a gravel road?
I do a lot of hunting, so I'm on gravel a lot.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So that can contribute to it a little bit there, too. So look at the – does it – when you go to fill it up with gas, does it take – can you put it up on the full notch and let it go? Will it take fuel, or does it kick off?
Oh, yeah.
Does it kick off
it's
a couple
fine.
Times? Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, like I said, I've noticed it last fall and then the spring. It just seems like when it's cold, it's on, and as soon as the day warms up, it goes off, and then as soon as it starts getting chilly in the afternoon, it'll come back on again.
Yep.
And it doesn't matter how much gas is in the truck or anything.
Okay. Yeah, I would start out – I'd start out looking at that gas cap and then plug a code reader in it and see if there's a –
I've heard you talk about diagnosing it.
Yep.
I'll find about 1,000 other things wrong with it.
Well, now, when you plug it in – I mean, if the check engine light's on, then you're going to find lots of things on. But if it's like this here, it's can store the code of what caused it to come on.
Sure.
You're not going to, you know, it's not going to all of a sudden when you plug it in, it's going to say, oh my gosh, I need a mass airflow sensor and all this other, you know, 10,000 things. If that was the case, your check engine light would be on all the time.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Today is the very first day since spring when we, you know, broke the cold weather.
Yep.
That so, came on. So it was like coincidental. I was listening to you guys. So.
Yeah. Pull off that gas cap and take a look at it.
Okay.
Okay.
Great.
And if you want, stop up to the shop and I'll plug it in for you too. And we'll look at the code there real quick. And
right.
I won't charge you anything for that.
All right.
Okay.
Thanks.
No problem.
You guys have a good day.
You
bye
too. Thanks for calling in.
All right. Shane in Walford. 365-0600, 1-800-332-5401, *600 on your U.S. cellular phone. Those are the three numbers to get a hold of us. Guess what time it is?
Oh, not another break.
Yep.
Break time. Hang on, guys.
Yep.
We'll get with you in just a minute.
We got Steve in Toddville and John in Cedar Rapids. If you guys just want to hold tight, we'll get to you as soon as we come back with more here on 600 WMT.
We're back.
We are.
There you go.
People thought we went away. No, we're still here.
Cool. We got lots of callers.
We do.
Lines open still.
Mm-hmm. 365-0600, 1-800-332-5401, *600 on your U.S. cellular phone. We got people been holding. We do appreciate that a lot. So we're going to go ahead and start with John in Cedar Rapids. Good morning, John.
Hello, guys.
Hey.
Hi.
What can we do for you?
My question is, I got a 07 F-150 4x4 Ford truck.
Okay.
It's the V8, the 5.4, and it does have the 3 valves per cylinder.
Yep.
Got 72,000 miles, roughly.
Okay.
And I've gotten so many different opinions on these platinum plugs.
Yeah.
You know, they're guaranteed to run 100,000 miles, and everybody I've talked to says don't run them 200,000 miles because you're going to end up breaking them off and paying more money to bore them out or do whatever you got to do to get the plug out.
That's incorrect, but okay, keep going.
Well, okay, and thank you for that. Second question is, I bought it from Zimmerman Ford, and I've always had my service work done there.
Perfect.
And they've always told, well, actually it says right on the gas cap to run premium fuel, and I've always run premium unleaded on all, I've always bought a new vehicle, so I've always run premium unleaded on all of them. And I've been told that running the premium will help it, you know, once it comes time to take the plugs out, so they don't break off. Is that true or false?
That's false, too.
Okay.
Okay. The design of that spark plug, I've seen them with 15,000 miles that we've taken the plug out and it breaks off. Okay, it's the design of the plug. When you get closer to that 100,000 miles, you get more of a chance that they're gonna break off.
I guess I'm not gonna wait because I want to do this sooner than later because right. I've heard, you know, from
the taking
several different automotive places that I've gone to. It's been around here for years in town. I've never come to you.
Yeah.
But just kind of wondered, you guys have there's certain places that have a flat rate and certain places say, well, it's $50 a plug if they break off the extractor.
Right. That we don't have a flat rate on it. But I tell you, it's not a big deal if they break off. If they have the right tool.
Right.
We've invested in the tool.
Okay.
And
so how much extra do you charge, basically, if one breaks off, I guess is my question.
I would have to double-check with my service manager, Jim, but I think the last time I saw it was like $25 a plug.
Oh, okay. So, well, that's pretty cheap.
Yeah, so it's not bad. Actually, my guys prefer it if the spark plug breaks off because it actually comes out better when it does break off.
Really?
Yeah, it's a weird deal, but
yeah.
But I would, that 70,000 to 80,000 miles is when I would like to see those plugs taken out of there.
Right.
The yep. Bummer is the spark plugs are stupidly expensive for that thing.
Yeah, they are. They're like $20 a piece.
Right. Yep. So, but yes, well, I would do that. And running premium fuel doesn't make a difference. Doesn't make it easier. Doesn't make it harder. Nothing of that sort.
Okay. Okay. All righty. Well, I appreciate your time then. Thank you.
No problem. Mm-hmm. Thanks for calling in.
You bet. Bye-bye.
Bye.
All right. Let's go now to Steve in Toddville. Steve, thanks for holding. How are you doing this morning?
Hey, pretty good. I've got a 2007 Town & Country minivan.
Okay.
And I was thinking about, it's not set up for flex fuel right now, but I was thinking about either converting it so it could be, or just wondering what would happen if I started burning like an E50 blend.
First off, it's hard on the fuel lines, and it's going to eat up the injectors because you don't have the right injectors, and it's going to run extremely warm as far as it's going to lean it out and run warm, and you take a chance of burning valves and burning a hole in a piston because the computer won't compensate for that. I've never heard of anybody converting one to run E85.
Okay. So there's not like a kit or something.
No, there's not a kit that you, not that I've seen. There's not a kit that converts it.
Okay.
So, the best thing to do is look, and there are some of those, the Chrysler vans that you can run the E85 on.
Right.
And I would look at trading. If running E85 is going to be a big deal to you, I would look at trading to get one of those.
Okay. So is E15 appropriate for a car like this, or
no,
how high could I go?
E15 is still too much. Just the normal ethanol blend is what it's set to run on. And you'll have check engine lights and you'll have running issues, and long term you'll have lots of bad things happen.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
I wouldn't do it.
All righty.
Okay.
Good. Thanks a lot, guys.
No mm-hmm. problem. Thank you.
Yeah, bye.
All right, thanks for the call this morning, Steve. Let's go to the 800 line now, where we have Al down in Muscatine. Good morning, Al.
Yes, I'm calling about a 5.4 engine in the pickups from 04 to maybe 010, and they have trouble with cam phasers.
Yeah.
And I was told to keep your oil clean.
Yep.
And maybe use 530 instead of 520, because the line that goes to the cam phaser is a lot smaller, and it takes oil pressure to make it work.
Well, the problem is the line is a lot smaller, and by going to 530, that's a thicker oil, and so now we got a smaller hole we're trying to put a thicker oil through. Okay, so I would not do that. Okay, I would stay at the 520 oil. The thing that I would do is, especially if you're starting out, it's lower mileage and that. I prefer running the quart of transmission fluid in with my oil change. Transmission fluid will help clean the engine. So if you can keep that smaller hole clean, the recommended oil is going to flow through it better, and we're going to have less chance of cam phaser problems.
Sounds good.
Okay. And that is a common problem on those, and it's a pain in the rear. So
yes, it is.
Yes, it is. So, but yep, just make sure we're keeping our oil clean. Put the transmission fluid in it is what I would recommend. And
you put the transmission fluid in right before you change oil?
No, I put when I change my oil. If like that system there is probably a 6-quart system. I would put
six and a half.
I'd put 5.5 quarts of my 520 oil and 1 quart of transmission fluid in it when I change my oil and leave that in there. Run it through the oil through your service. Always put short at 1 quart of oil and put 1 quart of transmission fluid in.
And run it the whole time.
Run it the whole time. Yep.
Sounds good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you for the call this morning, Al in Muscatine. 365-0600, 1-800-332-5401, *600 on your U.S. cellular phone. We got a few minutes here left, so go ahead and give us a call here if you got a question.
We got lots of time. Mm-hmm. Make them calls in here.
But you know what we got to do?
Don't go to break again.
No, I've got to.
Right now?
Yeah, right now.
Well, call in. Let's get the lines on. So we're going to go to break, and we'll get your calls back. Right after that.
Yep.
Awesome.
All right, be back with more here on 600 WMT. Right.
There you
California
go.
Dreaming.
There you go.
I'm sure the weather's nicer out in California than
it
is here.
I bet it is, too. But we got Kevin in Washington.
We do. So we're going to go ahead and talk to Kevin in Washington.
There we go.
Good morning, Kevin.
Hi. Good morning. How are you?
We are absolutely awesome.
Great. Hey, my question is on a 2003 Honda Civic.
Okay.
I keep getting a check engine light, and my mechanic tells me it's something to do with the gas, the filler neck, I believe.
Yep.
Or
got an evap
leak.
What
can you tell me about that? I did see a video on YouTube on replacing that. It looked pretty straightforward, and I just wanted to know what your thoughts on that were.
So your mechanic has diagnosed it and told you that you need a new filler neck?
Well, not per se, but I know it's something to do with the fill of the gas tank.
Okay. A lot of times we'll get the vent gets plugged up on those. Do you run a lot of gravel road?
Well, not a lot, but,
okay.
You know, it's still Iowa.
There you go. I would, you know, replacing the filler neck is not a big deal. I mean, it's not terrible, so that wouldn't be a problem to do. But just make sure that that's what we're...
Is that vent something you can clean, or is that just a replace deal?
On some of them, you can clean them. If they have a solenoid in them and a canister in that vent, that'll probably have to be replaced.
I think now that you've mentioned that, I think that sounds kind of more what he was talking about.
Right, and that's an easy enough thing to replace, too. So.
But that's given me that check engine light, and I've had them reset it, and the last time I did it was the next day, and it was back on again.
Yep.
So it's just kind of an annoyance thing.
I'm sure he's already checked it, but double check for me. Like we talked to that other caller earlier, look at the gas cap on it too. There's a rubber O-ring on there.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure that O-ring is good. One other little thing I've done before, just to test, is if the O-ring looks good, is I'll put just a little bit of Vaseline around the O-ring,
mm-hmm.
and run it for a week and see if that takes care of it, too. The Vaseline will help seal it up a little bit better.
Okay. But he did mention some kind of canister, so that's probably
what it is.
What it is. Okay.
Yep.
Well, thank you very much, you guys. Have
no
a
problem.
Great day, and go Hawks.
There you
All
go.
Right.
Thanks for calling in, Kevin.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Bye.
All right. I think we got time to squeeze in one last phone call
Let's talk to Jim and Letts.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Good morning, Jim.
Good morning.
Where
got a question. I got a 94 Toyota, little Toyota pickup.
Okay.
Four-cylinder.
Yep.
And it's got a little noise in the engine.
Okay.
When it first started, like, it just kind of rattles a little bit.
Okay.
And sometimes you're going down the road, you can hear it.
Okay. Does it go away once it warms up? Or do you hear it all the time? I mean, can you hear it?
I don't hear it all the time, but even when it's warm, you hear it.
Okay. It's possible. How many miles did it have on it?
130.
Okay. You could, those got some, should have an automatic timing belt or timing chain tensioner, or you could have a lifter that's sticking every once in a while. Either case, the first thing I would do is my transmission fluid trick. Change your oil and add a quart of transmission fluid to the oil change and run it and see if that brings it out of it. That'll help clean up if it's got a sticky lifter or something. Okay?
I see. Somebody said something about wrist pins.
Well, it could be. That's going to sound more down and deep into the motor. So.
I see.
Okay.
It only holds 4-quart oil.
Put 3.5 quarts of oil and 0.5 quart of transmission fluid in her then.
Oh.
Okay?
Okay.
Sounds
good. I'll
try
that.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's the end of the show.
That is. It goes fast when you get callers.
Yep. Don't forget, we're on the corner of 16th Avenue and Williams Boulevard, right next to the great, big, beautiful Tysons.
Mm-hmm.
And 396-2698. And my beautiful Shelly will put you through to whoever you want to talk to during the week. And Joyce is there on Saturday to get you.
That's right. Well, Jay, thanks again. Always a pleasure to have you in here.
Hey, thanks for having me.
So thanks to all the callers who called out there. That does it for me this morning here. Coming up at next, we'll get the Wall Street Weekend. And then 11:30, we have the Bump Brigade with Andy Peterson and JK from down in Iowa City. Pregame for the Iowa-Iowa State game. Everybody have a good morning.
The preceding Car Geek Hour is a paid advertisement program provided by Cassill Motors.